Perfectly captures what it feels like, what it looks like when a husband and wife are disconnected, when there's conflict, when there's a wedge between husband and wife, when being one feels like you're miles apart. And I know that for some of you right now, there are tears. And if those tears could speak, they would tell stories of frustration and anger and pain. Because although you're one, you're disconnected. And all of us who are married, we know what it's like to be in this spot. Maybe it was a day or a week or a season, or maybe you're in that spot right now. And you know what it feels like when these competing loyalties, so many good things in our lives, pull us away from the oneness that we're supposed to experience with our spouse. And I know some of you even know the pain of being betrayed by the one that you've pledged your life to. And so this weekend, we're going to take a look at what God's Word says to those of us who are in this spot right now. What God's Word says about why we get to this point in marriage and how we can get out of it. This weekend, we're going to look at how we can stay loyal to our spouse in this world of competing loyalties. And so if you would, let's start the way we always do. Grab a Bible and grab a pen. And if you don't have a Bible, there should be a hardback Bible somewhere near you. And you're going to need a pen this weekend. You're going to want a pen because we're going to walk through an experience at the end of the message. So ushers are coming forward right now. Raise your hand if you need a pen, and they'll make sure you get a pen. And on the back of your bulletin is a great spot to take notes. And this weekend, in the bottom right, there's a little spot that says assessment priorities, and it numbers 1 through 5. Leave that blank until the very end. We're going to walk through that together at the end. So make sure you leave that blank. We're in this series we're calling Keep Your Vow, and we're looking at what God's Word says to those of us who are married on what it looks like to reflect God and have a great marriage and show people who Jesus is based on how we love our spouse. And last week, we kicked off the series by looking at this idea of fighting fair. How do we fight fair? We said healthy couples fight fair, unhealthy couples fight dirty. And we said if you're going to fight fair with your spouse, you got to do 3 things. You got to listen carefully, choose your words wisely, and you got to manage your anger righteously. And if you missed out, go online and catch up and watch that. Sit down with your spouse if you're married to watch that message from last week and get caught up. But this weekend, we're looking at this idea of stay loyal. What does it look like to stay loyal, to stay faithful to our spouse in good times and bad? And here's the big idea, and I want you to write this down. The big idea this weekend is this. Staying loyal, the key to staying loyal means that we pursue the one with our two. Staying loyal means we pursue the one with our two. Now, of course, the one is God, and the two is our spouse. And Craig Groeschel of Life Church first used this phrase, and it caught me when I heard it. And I said, yes, that's true, and it's memorable, and it's so valid. If we pursue the one with our spouse, if we pursue God with our spouse, chances are we'll stay loyal to God and loyal to our spouse. And here's what I know about marriage. If we are disloyal to God, we will be disloyal to our spouse all the time. It starts by being loyal to God. And loyalty in our lives starts in our relationship with Jesus Christ. It starts with our priorities. Loyalty is all about the order of our lives. What do we put first? What do we put second? What do we cherish? What do we value? What do we spend our time and our energy and our focus on? Is it God? Is it our spouse? Is it something else? And here's what I know. When you're young, when you're newly married, it's really easy to stay loyal, right? You're feeling the tinglies. You're feeling awesome. And you don't have a lot of responsibilities. And then all of a sudden, as you get older and as marriage goes on, life creeps in. And there's all these competing loyalties that we face. Some of them good things. Some of them great things. But oftentimes, our life gets disordered. And we end up putting things above God or putting things above our spouse. And our loyalty is ruined, and it leads to all different kinds of problems in our relationship with our spouse. In 2004 and 2005, my wife and I walked through a really difficult season where most days we experienced the kind of disconnect that video described. And here's what happened in 2004 and 2005. We'd been married for about 5 years, and in July, we had our son. Became parents for the first time, changed everything. And those of you who are parents and new parents know, it flips everything upside down in the most beautiful way. But all of a sudden, you've got this child that you've got to care for, and your loyalty can sometimes get divided. And then after Xavier's about 4 months old, we moved from Colorado, the Denver area, to Lincoln, Nebraska. We both quit our jobs. We moved our family to Lincoln, Nebraska. And I started a job at a church as a youth pastor. It was a big church, and my job was to start a youth program from the ground up. And all of a sudden, I began to feel the weight of that responsibility. And I began to take some of that home with me. And we moved to an apartment, and then we bought a townhome, and now we've got a mortgage. And then we had to buy a bigger car because our car seat was too big, and we had to change car seats. And you know that whole rigmarole you go through. And all of a sudden, there were all these competing loyalties in our marriage that began to pull my wife and I apart. There were cracks in our marriage, and those cracks became gaps. And pretty soon, those gaps became like canyons. And we began to feel very disconnected from one another. My wife started to walk through postpartum depression. We didn't expect it. We didn't know how to deal with that. And I started to have anxiety issues. I started having panic attacks, literally, not knowing what was going on because I was feeling the weight and the burden of all these competing things in my life. And they were pulling my wife and I apart. By God's grace, we got through that season. But I look back going, I never want to go to that spot. And I'm telling you, the way that we got out is simply by pursuing God together, by forgiving one another over and over, by loving one another well, but it wasn't easy. We have to put God first, to put our spouse second. I know there's a lot of competing loyalties in our lives. There's a lot of things that compete for our time and our affection and our attention, but God has to be first and our spouse has to be second. In a world of competing loyalties, this is what loyalty should look like in our lives. If we're married and have kids, you ready? This is what loyalty should look like. God is always first, whether you're married or single. Spouse is always second if you're married. Children are always third if you've got kids. Career and work are oftentimes fourth. Then friends, hobbies, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth. I'm not so concerned with what's fifth, sixth, or seventh in your life, but I'm very concerned about what's first and what's second. You see, too often we get things out of order. Too often we jumble things around. Too often we put things above God. We worship things, even good things that aren't God as God. And when we take a good thing or a great thing like children and work, and we make that a God thing, we're disloyal to God, and we're going to end up being disloyal to our spouse. The Bible calls this idolatry, this idea of putting someone or something above God, of letting our loyalty to God be ruined. The Bible calls that idolatry. And I want you to turn in your Bibles with me to Exodus chapter 20, and we're going to look at what God says about putting him first. In Exodus chapter 20, the Bible goes Genesis, then Exodus. God had just delivered his people from Egypt. The Israelites were free. They've been captive for hundreds of years, and now they're free. And they're in the wilderness, and they're wandering, and they're grumbling to God. And God gives them in Exodus chapter 20, the Ten Commandments. And so I'm going to read to you Starting in verse 1, what God's word says in Exodus 20. It says, "And God spoke all these words, 'I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery.'" You see, before God gives the commands, he reminds his people, "This is who I am. I'm the Redeemer. I'm the Deliverer. I have rescued you. Remember my power. Remember my love and my strength." And whenever God gives us commands in the Bible, he always does so by reminding us first who we are in Christ and his power and his strength and what he's done. Verse 3, commandment number 1, "You shall have no other gods before me." First thing God says is this: I'm first. I'm the top priority. Your affections, your heart should be for me first. And then in verse 4, he says this: "You shall not make for yourselves an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God." The first commandment God gives is, "I'm first. I'm your priority. I'm number one. I'm God." The second commandment is this: do not worship created things. Don't worship created things. Worship the Creator instead. And here's the thing. I don't know about you, but I've read through the Old Testament. And you read through the Old Testament, you hear over and over again how God's people wander. They're faithful for a while, then they wander away and they melt down all their jewelry and they worship a golden calf. And we read these stories and we're like, how stupid are these people, right? Like, come on. Like, we would never do that. We would never worship an animal or a creature. But here's the problem. We do it all the time. It just looks different in 2015. See, you and I in our lives oftentimes exalt things above God all the time. Things like work, our children, things like freedom or pleasure or money or prestige or status or control. There are so many good things that we can elevate to God things, and they become bad things if they're idols in our life. We do this all the time. We are just like the Israelites. We're just like the nation of Israel. We know our hearts are prone to wonder. And the Bible says that before we ever bow a knee to someone or something other than God, we bow our hearts first. Idolatry, disloyalty begins in the heart. It always starts here. And I want you to turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 14, and we're going to read about idolatry of the heart. Of disloyalty of the heart. And if you're not sure where Ezekiel is, you're not alone. I'm going to help you get there. If you turn the middle of your Bible, you'll find the book of Psalms. And if you turn right towards the New Testament, you'll get through all the wisdom literature. You'll get through Proverbs and Song of Solomon. And you'll get to two big prophetic books, Isaiah, Jeremiah, then it's Lamentations, then Ezekiel. And Ezekiel chapter 14, Ezekiel the prophet is prophesying to people in exile. God's people kept wandering away. They kept worshiping false gods. And so God allowed his people to be deported from the promised land, to be carried away into exile. And so Ezekiel and a lot of Israelites around him are in Babylon. They're in a foreign land. And he's writing these words about 590 BC to a people who God is disciplining, to a people who have worshiped false gods and false idols and who've walked away because they've been disloyal to God. And in Ezekiel 14, starting in verse 1, this is what the Bible says. He says, "Some of the elders of Israel came to me and sat down in front of me. Then the word of the Lord came to me, 'Son of man, these men have set up idols in their,'" what's that word? "Hearts. And have put wicked stumbling blocks before their faces. Should I let them inquire of me at all?" God says, "Listen, Ezekiel, these people have worshiped other things with their hearts. Their hearts are not turned towards me. Should I even listen to these people?" And then in verse 4, it says, "Therefore speak to them and tell them, 'This is what the sovereign Lord says. When any of the Israelites set up idols in their hearts and put wicked stumbling blocks before their faces and then go to a prophet, I, the Lord, will answer them in keeping with their great idolatry.'" And then verse 5 describes why God listens even when we wander away. "I will do this to recapture the hearts of the people of Israel who have all deserted me for their idols." Idolatry begins in the heart. And here's what you need to know. Even when you're running 1,000 miles the wrong direction away from God, his grace is sufficient to pull you back in. God listens even when your heart is turned away, even when you're running away, even when you're disloyal to God and disloyal to your spouse. God hears because he wants your heart. God wants your desires. He wants your affections. He wants a relationship with you. And because of that, Jesus listens even when we walk away. Even when our hearts aren't desiring God first. Idolatry Disloyalty to God always begins in the heart. And it always begins when we elevate something above God. I've got a quote that I want to read to you. And this is from a pastor named Tim Keller. Tim Keller is a pastor of Redeemer Church in Manhattan, New York. And he wrote a book called Counterfeit Gods. And it's all about this idea of being disloyal to God and being disloyal to our spouses. And here's what he says. I want you to read along with me. He says, "What is an idol? It is anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God. Anything you seek to give you what only God can give. A counterfeit God is anything so central and essential to your life that should you lose it, your life would hardly feel like living. An idol is whatever you look at and say in your heart of hearts, if I have that, then I'll feel my life has meaning. Then I'll know that I have value. Then I'll feel significant and secure. If anything becomes more fundamental than God to your happiness, meaning in life, and identity, then it is an idol." See, friends, when we're disloyal to God, we're going to be tempted to be disloyal to our spouse over and over and over. When we're disloyal to God, we violate the first commandment and the second commandment, and we violate the greatest commandment that says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. So what does it look like when we're disloyal? I mean, practically in a marriage or in a family, what does it look like when we're elevating things above God? Or when we're not putting our spouse in the second priority spot in our lives? What happens when we're disloyal to God and our spouse? I'm going to give you four scenarios that happen. And I've seen these happen over and over again in marriages and in families. It's like a cul-de-sac. These things just get played out over and over and over. And here's the first scenario. If you elevate your spouse to the spot of God, if you put your spouse on a pedestal, if you idolize your spouse, if you're worshiping your spouse and not God, here's what happens. You're going to crush your spouse under the weight of your own expectations. If you're looking to your spouse and not God to give you meaning and purpose and fulfillment and forgiveness and ultimate worth and value and security, pretty soon your husband or your wife is going to buckle under the stress and the weight of your expectations. And I know a lot of couples will say, well, I don't do this, and I would never do that. But I know a lot of people that wouldn't say they do that, but in their heart of hearts, they'd admit, no, I do. I put my wife on a pedestal. I put my husband on a pedestal. I know a lot of young couples who going into marriage have these preconceived ideas that this is what my wife will do, and this is what my husband will do, and they have all these expectations. And instead of putting them on God, and instead of looking to God, they look to their spouse. And their spouse ends up just buckling and getting crushed under the weight of your expectations for them. And ultimately, when you're disloyal in that way, it leads to all kinds of conflict because all of a sudden you become bitter and angry that your spouse isn't doing enough. Your spouse isn't doing what you need them to do for you. They're not being enough or there for you enough or making you feel secure enough because only God can do that. Another scenario that plays out a lot in marriage is oftentimes when God is number one, he's our focus, he's our priority, but we let other things compete for number two with our spouse. And we devalue our spouse, and we don't do it intentionally, but we let competing loyalties creep in, and all of a sudden our marriage starts to buckle and crack and pull apart because we're putting things like children or work or our hobbies or a home improvement project or a ministry that we are involved in front of our spouse. And here's what happens. If you're trying to be loyal to God, but you're disloyal to your spouse, here's what's going to happen. You're going to neglect your spouse. You're going to stop investing in your spouse. You're going to stop pursuing your spouse. And pretty soon, things like emotional affairs and adultery and pornography and fighting and conflict happen. Why? Because we're not treasuring God first and our spouse second. We're not investing in our marriage. It's not a priority. We're being disloyal to our spouse by what we say and what we do and what we value and how we prioritize our lives. And so many marriages hit this point and people think, well, I just need to upgrade, right? I just need a different spouse. If this marriage isn't working, it's too hard. And what's happening is you're not prioritizing your spouse. And you're going to be disloyal to your spouse over and over again if your spouse isn't the second priority in your life. Now, I've also seen this scenario play out a lot in marriage where children become the focus. Instead of having a Christ-centered marriage and a Christ-centered family, it's a child-centered marriage and a child-centered family where children are put up on a pedestal and everything in the family revolves around the kids, their activities, their performance, their achievement. Parents begin to live vicariously through their kids and their kids' success, and everything is put on the kids. The kids dare not fail because if they fail, they will destroy the family. I know so many marriages where I'll sit down with a couple and they're fighting and arguing. I'll say, tell me what's going on. And I'll have a wife look at me with just great agony and say, for 5 or 10 or 15 or 20 years, we've raised our kids and now we don't know how to be married. We don't know how to respond to one another. We've grown apart for 20 years as we've raised our kids because the kids have been the focus. They've been up there in God's spot. They've been on the pedestal. And let me tell you what else happens in this spot. If you put your kids on that pedestal, they feel that pressure. And I've seen so many kids crumble and fall apart because they know that they can't fail. And then when they fail, it's like the family falls apart, the world falls apart, and they feel that pressure. Friends, if we put our kids on a pedestal, if we make them the focus of our marriage or the focus of our family, ultimately we're disloyal to God and we're disloyal to our spouse and we're disloyal to our kids. And finally, I've seen this happen over and over again when people don't put God first, but they put work first. They put career and achievement and status and worldly success above God or above their spouse, and it's all about the title. Whatever title they can achieve, it's about the education they're pursuing, it's about the degree, it's about earning more, finally getting that name, that title, achieving that status, because they believe if I get there, then finally I'll be worth something. Finally, my life will have meaning if I just get to that level or that point or that job or that place. And so many marriages fall apart, and so many of us are disloyal because we put our careers before our spouse, and sometimes we even put our careers before God. And if I'm honest, this is where I struggle the most in this. Because my job, ministry, serves my number one priority, God. And it's so easy for me to allow ministry to be a competing loyalty for my affections for God. And it's so easy for me to see my ministry intertwined with my relationship with God. And it's so easy for me to work harder than I should, longer than I should, and neglect my wife and neglect my son. And you can ask them and they will tell you, this is what I struggle with. This is the area where I'm tempted to put something good or something great before God. And my wife and my son feel it every time I do. Because check this out, very few people are gonna look at me and say, hey, pastor, you're working too hard, right? But my wife will, my son will. When we get things disordered, we become disloyal to God and disloyal to our spouse, and it causes all different kinds of breakdowns in our relationship with each other. So the question is this: what happens when we are disloyal to God and our spouse? Over time, what happens? I want you to turn to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians 6 in the New Testament. So you were in the Old Testament in Ezekiel. The New Testament goes Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1st, 2nd Corinthians, then Galatians. It's a small book. And in chapter 6, Paul writes to the church at Galatia, and he gives them a principle, a truth about how we live our lives and what we prioritize and what matters. In Galatians 6, starting in verse 7, here's what he says to the church. Do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. Whoever sows to please their flesh from the flesh will reap destruction. But whoever sows to please the Spirit from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Let us not become weary in doing good, for in the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Here's what Paul just said. We know this. Grace is the great interrupter, right? Grace gives us what we don't deserve. And we're saved by grace through faith. But here's what Paul says about life. If you're disloyal to God, if you're disloyal to your spouse, if your affections and loyalties aren't lined up with God, you're going to reap destruction. A year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, if your path isn't altered, that's the way you're headed. That's the trajectory of your life. But then he says, listen, if you're sowing seeds for God, if you're loyal to God and loyal to your spouse, and you're walking that trajectory a year from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, you're going to reap a harvest of righteousness, and it's going to be beautiful. So the question this weekend is this: what kind of a harvest is your life producing right now? What kind of a harvest should you expect from the way you're living your life? If the trajectory that you're on right now continues for a year or 5 or 10, what is your relationship with Jesus going to look like? What is your marriage going to look like? What is your family going to look like? If you stay on this path, on this trajectory, wherever you're at right now, what kind of a harvest is waiting for you in your life right now? And here's the question this weekend. How do we stay loyal? You say, okay, Pastor, idolatry's bad. I don't want to go there. And maybe you're in that spot right now. What do we do to guard our hearts? What do we do to make sure that we are loyal to God and loyal to our spouse? What can we do practically to make this happen? And there's three things we're going to look at this weekend. And I want you to write these three things down. Three things we can all do to stay loyal to our spouse and first and foremost to God. Number one, write this down. The first thing you can do to stay loyal to God and your spouse is to pursue God together. Pursue the one with your two. The best thing you can do in marriage to stay loyal to God and to each other is to pursue God together, to seek God with your hearts together. Now, we all know this famous statistic, right? 50% of marriages end in divorce. The problem is that includes all the second, third, fourth, and fifth remarriages and divorces, okay? So the actual divorce rate's about 40% in America. And we also hear this statistic, but in the church, it's the same as outside the church, right? And they've done incredible studies. And there was a study that was done recently that actually dug a little bit deeper by a man named Bradford Wilcox, University of Virginia. And he's a part of the National Marriage Project. And they did a study, not just asking people like studies usually do, like, are you a Christian? Do you go to church? Where 80% of Americans are like, yes and yes, right? But he asked questions of spouses about what they really do with their faith. He asked questions like, do you go to church more than once a month? Do you read your Bible with your spouse? Do you pray with your spouse? Do you serve with your spouse? And here's what he found. If couples said, yes, I'm a Christian, yes, I go to church, but they didn't check any of the other boxes, they were actually 20% more likely than people that don't believe in God to get divorced. Think about that. People that just say, I'm a Christian, I go to church at Christmas and Easter and every now and then, but they don't pray with their spouse, they don't really worship regularly with their spouse, they don't serve with their spouse, they don't read God's word, they're 20% more likely than someone who doesn't even go to church to get divorced. But here's what he found. For couples that check those boxes, yes, we pray together. Yeah, we read the Bible together. Yeah, we worship regularly together. Yeah, we serve together. They were 35% less likely to get divorced, which means they were 55% less likely to get divorced than people that just said, I'm a Christian and yeah, I go to church sometimes, right? Here's what matters in your marriage. Here's what matters in your loyalty. Whether or not you are pursuing Jesus with your spouse, it's not what you say you believe. It's how you live your life that matters. This is simple, but it's profound. If you pray with your spouse regularly, if you go to church, if you serve together, if you break open God's word together, chances are you're going to be loyal to God and loyal to your spouse. They did another study that found that couples that pray together often have less than a 1% chance of divorce. Why? Because they're living their faith together. They're pursuing Jesus together. Now, some of you right now I know are already pushing back and you're saying, okay, Pastor, that sounds great, but my wife doesn't believe. My husband doesn't believe. I can't get his butt to church. So what do I do, right? Here's what you do if that's you in this spot. You pursue Jesus as much as you can, as passionately as you can, by yourself first. If that's you, your job is to pursue Jesus in such a way that your spouse can't help but notice how you live your life differently because of Jesus. And your other job is this: pray for your spouse every single day. Bug God over and over and over again. God, I want you to rescue him. God, he's still not a Christian, right? God, he still won't pray with me. And just work on God every single day. Lord, here's what I want. Lord, here's my desire. Here's my desire. And watch what God does. It may take 5 years or 10 years of fervent prayer, but I've heard story after story after story of the praying spouse who prayed daily and finally God moved. Pursue the one with your two. That's the best way to stay loyal to God, the best way to stay loyal to your spouse. The second thing we can all do to stay loyal to God and to our spouse is this: set boundaries. You gotta set boundaries. Cut out opportunities for being disloyal. We've gotta be wise about the way that we live our lives. We can't be foolish. And there's three areas that constantly come up in marriage counseling that are problem areas for couples. Ready? Three things. I want you to write these three things down. The first one we're going to go through is this: social media, right? Social media is often a problem in marriage. And here's how it plays out in a relationship. A husband or wife is on Facebook and an old flame from high school sends them a friend request. And you, oh, cool. Okay, I want to see what she's up to. And you click accept. And all of a sudden you look at her and you're going, man, she's in good shape. She's done well since high school, right? Oh, and she's single. Wow, that's neat. So you like a couple photos. Then she sends you a personal message that nobody else can see, and you start to feel these emotions. and this attraction, and you feel your affection getting pulled away from God or pulled away from your spouse, and before you know it, you're wrapped up in this emotional affair or an actual affair because you didn't set boundaries around social media. And so here's what I always tell couples to do. Here's what I always give the advice. Ready? Give your usernames and passwords on all social media sites to your spouse. Email, your phone password, your internet history, Facebook, Twitter, as long as it's not like sacred work stuff, right? Give usernames and passwords to your spouse and then give them permission to check up. Not hypervigilantly and crazy like every 5 minutes, but give them permission to see where you've been going online. Give them permission to see who you've been talking about and who you've been searching for on Facebook, right? And I get pushback all the time from couples and like, well, don't you think we trust each other? And my answer is always yes. That's why this isn't a problem, right? The only way this is a problem if you're keeping a secret or you're shadowing or you're shading things a little bit with your spouse. If there's no secrets, then there's no problem, right? If you trust your spouse, this is a non-issue. We gotta be careful on social media, how we live and the things that we click on and the things that we let into our hearts and into our marriage. I've seen so many marriages dissolve because someone went too far on social media first. The second area that you've gotta be careful and set boundaries is this work. It's work. So many people become disloyal to their spouse and it starts somewhere at work. There's a coworker you start talking to, you start flirting with, and then you start doing lunches together, and there may be a business trip, right? And so here's what you need to do, particularly if husband and wife both work outside the home. Here's what you need to do. You need to set boundaries. If you're on a business trip, you need to do things like this. Be accountable to your spouse. Check in with them at regular intervals and say, I'm gonna call you here and here and here because I wanna be accountable to you on this trip. Find somebody on the trip with you and say, hey, here's how I wanna live. Here's how I wanna do this business trip. Help me do this well, keep me accountable. Let me not go where I shouldn't go and let me not do what I shouldn't do. And if you're at work, here's a question you constantly need to ask yourself. If my spouse was standing next to me, would I say this or would I do this? If my spouse was standing next to me at work, would I say this to this person? Would I do this around this person if my spouse was right here? And if the answer is no, you don't do it. You set a boundary and say, hey, that's not where I should be. You gotta set boundaries at work. The third area that you gotta set boundaries, and this comes up more than you'd think, is the gym, all right? The gym, and here's why this is a problem. You've got a lot of fit, attractive, half-naked people moving their bodies in a small room with a lot of mirrors, right? What could possibly go wrong in there, right? And here's what you gotta do if you're working out at the gym. You gotta mind and be mindful of what you're thinking of and what you're looking at. At the gym, what are you thinking of and what are you looking at? And here's what you might need to do. Here's some boundaries you might need to set in place at the gym. You might need to switch the times or the dates that you go work out. It's plain and simple. If there's someone there that you're drawn towards, if there's someone there that you're flirting with, you might need to switch up your routine, your day, your time. You might even need to switch the place you work out at because it's been a problem or it's gonna be a problem and you know it. You might need to actually work out with your spouse. And I know if you got kids, sometimes it's hard because you do the rotation thing, but you might need to figure out a way to work out with your spouse. Why? Because it's simple boundaries like that that help us stay loyal. It removes a lot of those barriers and a lot of those obstacles, but we've got to set boundaries around social media, around work, and around the gym. I'm telling you, over and over and over again, those things keep coming up in marriage counseling. It's crazy. The second thing we do is we set boundaries. The third and final thing that we do to make sure that we can stay loyal to God and to our spouse is this. We confess sin, struggle, and idolatry. We confess sin and struggle and idolatry, and here's why. We've already read, we've already learned that idolatry begins in the heart. It's what we feel. It's our affections. It's our desires. We bow our hearts before we bow our knee to anything or anybody. It's about our hearts. And here's what I know. If you confess sin to your spouse before it becomes a massive problem, you're gonna grow closer to your spouse and you're gonna be more loyal to God and your spouse. James 5:16 says this, therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. We need to confess our sins to our spouse. And this is difficult and this is painful. But my wife and I have had to walk through this together before. We've had to sit down and say, hey, honey, I am attracted to this person at work in a way that I shouldn't be. And it's embarrassing and it's hard to admit, but you need to know that. And you need to know that not because you're inadequate or because this is your fault. It's my fault, but you need to know so that you can pray for me, so that you're aware of this, and so that this secret doesn't become a problem. We've had to do that in our marriage before. And I'm telling you what happens. At first, it's uncomfortable and it's hard, and you're like, holy cow, I can't ever imagine saying that to my spouse. In the end, you grow closer because you confess and you experience God's grace, and you understand again that the gospel is good news, and that even when you fall, there's grace. And what you do is, when you confess those things before they become affairs, before they become real problems, you confess those desires before they take root and before they grow and before they become a real, real problem. And so you have to confess things to your spouse. If you're putting something before your spouse, you got to sit down and say, honey, I'm putting work before you and I don't want to do this. Help me out with this. You say things like, I feel like we're putting our children above our marriage. Let's sit down and talk about how we can work through that. We have to confess those things to our spouse, because in the end, it brings healing and it brings hope and reminds us of the grace of Jesus Christ that we need every single day. Don't keep secrets. Secrets only lead to trouble. They only lead to disloyalty. You've got to confess those things, as hard and as painful as those things are sometimes. And not only to our spouse, but here's what you need to do. You need to confess to your kids. Now, I'm not saying confess your deepest, darkest secrets to your kids, especially when they're little, but here's what I need you to do. When you sin and your kids know it, you need to go to your kids and say things like this: Daddy's sorry. Mommy needs Jesus just like you do. Will you forgive Mommy? Daddy blew it, and I'm sorry, man. We need to confess our sins to our spouse. Why? Because when we do two things. Number one, we show them that we're not hypocritical, that we need Jesus just like they do. And the second thing we do is we teach our kids how to repent, so that when our kids grow up and get older, they know that they need the grace of Jesus. They know that it's okay to confess sin. They know that they're going to have to turn and repent of things, and they know how to do, because here's what happens if you don't. Your kids grow up, and they're either hypocritical, or they struggle because they start to struggle with sin, and they don't know what to do with it, because you never modeled how to repent and how to confess and how to apologize and say you're sorry. But when you teach your kids how to do that, they grow up knowing how to do that because you modeled it for them. One of the best ways to stay loyal to God and to your spouse is to confess sin, confess idolatry. When you're worshiping someone or something other than God, just sit down with your spouse and say, hey, this is what's really going on inside of me, and you need to know this, and we need to pray through this. And because we take this really seriously, we're going to close the service this weekend by giving you an opportunity to do just that. And so normally what we do is your campus pastor would come up and we close down the service that way. But this weekend, we're going to give you an opportunity to assess where you're at, your life, your heart, your priorities, your loyalties, where they lie. And on your bulletin, I've already made reference to this, but there's a spot in the corner that says assessment priorities, and it lists 1 through 5. We're going to give you space right now in this spot to pray and ask God, Lord, what are my priorities? Where are my affections? Where are my desires? How am I living my life right now? And we want you to write these down. And some of you might not be comfortable writing them down. That's okay. But in this space, what I want you to do is pray through them and think about them. And if you're not sure where they're at right now, in this space and time, I want you to ask God, hey, Lord, where are my loyalties? God, where are my priorities? What am I putting above you, if anything, Lord? Where am I? And we're going to give you plenty of time and space to do this and to fill this out. Here's what I know. It's really easy to be convicted during a message, during a worship service, and then turn around and walk out the door and not live any differently. We've got to have an opportunity to be honest and actually put some things down in writing on paper. So we're going to give you a chance to do that now. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray, and then we're just going to play some music and give you an opportunity just to, in this space, identify where you're at. And if you're with your spouse, I would ask you, as you and your spouse identify these things, to talk about them. And if it's not here, go home and talk about them this weekend and say, hey, this is where I'm at. Where are you at? Let's talk about this. Let's pray through this. Let's confess things that we need to confess. Let's make sure that our marriage is healed. Let's make sure we put God first and each other second. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to walk through this together. Let's pray. God, we know that ultimately in this life, you alone are worthy of praise and worship and honor. God, so often we let the competing loyalties of this world, even good things, God, pull at our relationship with you and make us disloyal to you. And God, oftentimes we put things before our husbands and our wives. God, we are disloyal to them because we let competing loyalties barge in and create division and conflict. And Lord, we know that your grace meets us right where we are. And God, we're asking that in this place, your grace would meet us here. That God, where we need conviction, that you would provide that. Where we need clarity in our priorities, you would provide that. God, where we need to repent and confess, that God, you would give us the courage to do that well. God, we know that we can't run too far from your grace. That God, you want to recapture our hearts. So God, recapture our hearts in this moment as we pray. It's in Jesus' name we all pray. Amen.